Look here is Rama, look there is Rama, look anywhere is Sri Rama. Look into poetry, there's Rama. Look into paintings, there's Rama. Look into theatre, there's Rama. Look into sculpture, there's Rama. Forget about arts, look around, there's Rama. Many places in India are named after Rama. And people relive Rama's story in their actual lives. For example, in Karnataka, when a girl is being sent to the husband's house after marriage, they sing a song, a folk song, Janaka Rajana Magara Bona Durege Gut Kuttu, Kalyana Ve Sita Kalyana Ve, Loka Palakara Sutra Da Bombege Kalyana Ve Sita Kalyana Ve. Janaka Raja's daughter is being married to, to Dasharatha's son, but after all, she is the puppet in the hands of men who rule the world. So this is a folk song. And places, several places in Karnataka, they said this is where during Vanavasa Rama and Sita stay. This is where one day Rama wanted to apply his nama. There's no water, there was only a stone. He took out his arrow and shot the rock, and water oozed out, and that became a fountain. So innumerable stories like this in the place myths of Karnataka and all over the world. And Rama is everywhere in Karnataka, in Tamil Nadu, North India, South India, all over Southeast Asia. D.D. Kosambi said that Buddhism is the greatest gift that India gave to Southeast Asia. I agree with him, but maybe the second greatest gift that India gave to Southeast Asia and to the rest of the world is the Ramayana. Why only Ramayana? Why not Mahabharata? Mahabharata also traveled to Southeast Asia, and I've seen the Mahabharata performances in the Bali Islands, where it's not Bhima, not Arjuna, not Krishna who's the hero, it is Sahadeva who's the hero. It's very interesting. But Rama play is much more popular, much more vibrant than the Mahabharata, little Mahabharata plays in Bali Islands. What is the reason for the popularity of the Ramayana? Way back in the 90s, Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts in New Delhi organized a week-long festival of Southeast Asian Ramayanas. I had the opportunity to interview the artists who performed this, and I asked them, why is Ramayana important to you? The actor who played Rama from Thailand said, we adore Rama, but because he was a good Buddhist. Indonesian artist said, we like Rama because he was a good man. So it's not a religious story for them. It's not because of religious reason that any story becomes popular. First of all, it's a good story. People the world over love good stories, and they want to tell these stories again and again, differently each time, and in their own individual ways. Therefore, we have many Ramayanas, which Professor Paula Richman talks about in her book. The people talk about 1,000 Ramayanas, there may be 1,000 more Ramayanas. There are so many Ramas. But these Ramas belong, infinite set of Ramas belong to a finite number of Rama types, which I'm going to talk about shortly. Basically, there are two Ramas. This will also address the question that Professor Vilimale asked in the morning about the kind of Rama cult which is now spreading in this country. There are two kinds of Ramas. I said in Kannada, which is my language, there is no popular Ramayana which can match the appeal and universality of Kannada Mahabharatas like Kumarvyasa Bharata or Jaimini Bharata. But there's a lot of Ramayana theatre, and many of our devotees, like saint singers, have composed innumerable episodes, songs on innumerable episodes of Rama's life. If you put them together, you can create a Bhakti Ramayana. Rama, for some people, is a god. Some people, he's a human being. When they talk, folk people talk about Sita being sent to the husband, so they're talking about Sita as if she's the girl next door. For Bhaktas, Rama is something else. This deification of Rama, Professor Setta was asking this question, when did it begin? It began way back in 7th century, because Kulashekara Alvar, one of the earliest Alvars, was great. He was a great Rama Bhakta. And whenever he went into, wherever he went, he carried an image of Rama with him. And he was so passionately involved in Ramayana, when his guru, every day he was reading out Ramayana, so Valmiki Ramayana to him. When he was reading out the story of Sita's abduction, he flew into a rage. How come somebody can abduct my mother? Immediately he raised his army. Come, let's go. Let's invade Lanka. Let's defeat Ravana. Bring Sita back. And he was so mad in his bhakti, he wouldn't listen to anybody. And he took his army. Then ministers didn't know what to do. Then Lord Rama took pity on him. He appeared before him. No, I've already defeated Ravana. You go back to your palace. Rest at peace, he said. Till then he wouldn't listen. So it was such a great Rama book. There's many compositions about Rama. And Karnataka also produced so many devotional, wonderful devotional poems about Rama. Tirumangaya Alvar also has many compositions about Rama in Tamil Nadu. Of course, you have Kamma Ramayana, and so on and so forth. So Rama has long been a god. In North India, there is Saguna Rama and Nirguna Rama. And Tulsidas cult is Saguna Rama. In Kabir Pant, it is Nirguna Rama. In South India, Rama is both Saguna and Nirguna, is both form and formless. So there are innumerable stories of the Ramayana. Even Kumarvyasa, when he wrote his Mahabharata, he tells us the reason why he doesn't want to write another Mahabharata story, Ramayana story. He says, Tirukidanu Paniraya, Ramayana da Kategadali. The Paniraya, that is Adishesha, who carries the burden of the whole world, is weighed down by so many Ramayana. There are so many Ramayanas already. Kalidalu yade illa, I have no place to put my foot. Therefore, I am telling the story of Mahabharata, not Ramayana, he says. Rama's story was so popular when Kumarvyasa wrote his magnificent Mahabharata. But we had to await 20th century for there to be a great literary epic on Rama. It was our great poet Kuvempu who wrote his Ramayana Darshanam. This Rama was totally different. This Rama is not the macho Rama. He is not the militant Rama. He is Rama who is more a mother than a father. And this Rama is not for or against anybody. He is the universal principle. So in Kuvempu's Ramayana Darshanam, Sri Ramayana Darshanam, when Rama takes his avatar, all the characters, Purandara has said, so many Ramas, there's so many other Ramayana characters, so many Hanumans, so many Ravanas, so many Sitas. So all these characters came down as avatars along with Rama. Because without these avatars, Rama avatar would be incomplete, Kuvempu says. So he is everybody and he is nobody. And he starts telling the story of the human Rama, who also becomes a divinity, and the poem concludes with Nirguna Rama. The last section of the poem, which is Rama's coronation, does not happen in the human world, does not happen in the mythical world. It happens in the state of Samadhi. It takes place in Sahasradhara. So Rama becomes the ultimate principle of yoga in Kuvempu's Sri Ramayana Darshanam. There's one kind of Rama. Rama, the mother. And there's another important depiction of Rama in our great modern poet Gopal Krishna Riga's poem, Rama Navami Adivasa. And this poem is such a dense poem, within some 8 stanzas, he condenses the whole of the Ramayana story. For him, Rama is the ultimate male principle, Purushottama. He says Valmiki was able to sculpt this character because he did tapasya. Like a Purusha, he did tapasya. Huttagattade chitta matte kettitenu Purushottamanayanta yanta rupareke. Unless somebody does tapasya so much that a snake house grows on him, how can that hand depict the story of this Purushottama, the best of men, Rama? He doesn't give any credence to divine intervention. Even Rama's birth, he says, is the result of human effort, Purusha Prayatna. Kausalya Dasharatha Putra Kamishtigare Hatatta Yetagare Trikala Chakra Asporti Sittu Srita Varishta Teja Damanir Kelapattu Vimandattu Nintagatani. When Kausalya and Dasharatha were performing the yagna of married life, that heat generated, that touched the wheel of the 3 times, and from there a spark came down into the earth and it put on the mortal earthen cloth and became Rama. So for him, Rama is Purushottama, male principle, fighting with the forces of darkness. He says, he vidrumbis with Rama Bana, Nija. When Rama shot his arrow, it penetrated darkness, yes. Kattalege hattetare nulare adosankya. Does darkness have 1 head, 2, 10? It's innumerable. Kattarisidare badava. The more you cut it, the more it grows. Beradu kattige baruva. It not only grows up, it starts suffocating you. Beradu kattige baruva. Anadi. Kodanda danda uhiga danda. It's beginningless, therefore, even kodanda danda, the arrow of Rama, was futile. So it's the Herculean effort of a human being and the ultimate failure of human efforts against the forces of darkness that Adiga depicts in his poetry. So one is Rama the protector. As Surdas said, Nirudhana Kadana Ram, that kind of Rama. On the other hand, Rama the fighter, the combatant, who fights a crusade against the forces of darkness. So now what we have, this male macho Rama, who has become important in our politics, in our thinking, and this is not the Rama that Surdas talked about. This is not the Rama that Gandhi talked about. This is not the Rama that Kuvempu talked about. And Kuvempu shows the depicts the fight between these two sides of Rama in his great play Shudra Tapasvi. In Ramayana we have the story of the Shambhuka. Shudra was doing tapasya, but then calamities begin to happen, and all these Brahmins go to Rama. Look, Shudra is doing tapasya, he has to be stopped. And according to the origin story, Rama goes and shoots this his arrow, Shambhuka, his hedges severed, but Kuvempu turns the story upside down. Rama knows, because he says, Karunalu Raghavanade Tappilla. Rama is so compassionate, he can never make any mistake. So Rama knows that he's a great tapasvi. But he doesn't say no to the Brahmins, he knows the worth of these Brahmins. He says, okay, yes, let's go. And when he releases his arrow, that arrow goes 3 times round the Shudra Tapasvi, the Shudra ascetic, and it comes back to Brahmins. And Brahmins start running away. Oh Rama, save us from this arrow. I said, it's for him, why did it come to you? Then he said, no, please save us. He said, no, I can't save you. He's a great ascetic, he's a great rishi. Shambhuka is a great rishi. Go and touch his feet. So all the Brahmins go and touch the feet of Shambhuka, and arrow comes back to Rama. So this is how a great poet depicted the struggle between the conflict between 2 images of Rama, and he upheld Rama, not the killer, Rama, not Rama the killer, but Rama the protector. So this we have to remember in today's context. I'm very happy Honorable Virupamudi is here. he has been making his individual journey with the Rama story through many works for over a decade now, and I'm very happy that he's also going to talk about his experience and expression of Rama. So without any more ado, I can keep it myself. So thank you very much. Look here, it's Rama. Look there, it's Rama. Look anywhere, it's Sri Rama. Look into poetry, there's Rama. Look into paintings, there's Rama. Look into theater, there's Rama. Look into sculpture, there's Rama. Forget about ours, look around, there's Rama. Many places in India are named after Rama. And people relive Rama's story in their actual lives. For example, in Karnataka, when a girl is being sent to the husband's house after marriage, they sing a song, a folk song, Janaka Rajana Magara Bona Durege Gut Kuttu, Kalyana Ve Sita Kalyana Ve, Loka Palakara Sutra Da Bombege Kalyana Ve Sita Kalyana Ve. Janaka Raja's daughter is being married to Dasharatha's son, but after all, she is the puppet in the hands of men who rule the world. So this is a folk song. And places, several places in Karnataka, they say this is where during Vanavasa Rama and Sita stay. This is where one day Rama wanted to apply his nama. There was no water, there was only a stone. He took out his arrow and shot the rock, and water oozed out, and that became a fountain. So innumerable stories like this in the place myths of Karnataka and all over the world. And Rama is everywhere, in Karnataka, in Tamil Nadu, North India, South India, all over Southeast Asia. D.D. Kosambi said that Buddhism is the greatest gift that India gave to Southeast Asia. I agree with him, but maybe the second greatest gift that India gave to Southeast Asia and to the rest of the world is the Ramayana. Why only Ramayana? Why not Mahabharata? Mahabharata also traveled to Southeast Asia, and I've seen Mahabharata performances in the Bali Islands, where it's not Bhima, not Arjuna, not Krishna who's the hero, it is Sahadeva who's the hero. It's very interesting. But Rama play is much more popular, much more vibrant than the Mahabharata, little Mahabharata plays in Bali Islands. What is the reason for the popularity of the Ramayana? Way back in the 90s, Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts in New Delhi organized a week-long festival of Southeast Asian Ramayanas. I had the opportunity to interview the artists who performed this, and I asked them, why is Ramayana important to you? The actor who played Rama from Thailand said, we adore Rama, but because he was a good Buddhist. Indonesian artist said, we like Rama because he was a good man. So it's not a religious story for them. It's not because of religious reason that any story becomes popular. First of all, it's a good story. People the world over love good stories, and they want to tell these stories again and again, differently each time, and in their own individual ways. Therefore, we have many Ramayanas, which Professor Paula Richman talks about in her book. The people talk about 1,000 Ramayanas, there may be 1,000 more Ramayanas. There are so many Ramas. But these Ramas belong, infinite set of Ramas belong to a finite number of Rama types, which I'm going to talk about shortly. Basically, there are two Ramas. This will also address the question that Professor Vilimale asked in the morning about the kind of Rama cult which is now spreading in this country. There are two kinds of Ramas. I said in Kannada, which is my language, there is no popular Ramayana which can match the appeal and universality of Kannada Mahabharatas like Kumarvyasa Bharata or Jaimini Bharata. But there's a lot of Ramayana theatre, and many of our devotees, like saint singers, have composed innumerable episodes, songs on innumerable episodes of Rama's life. If you put them together, you can create a Bhakti Ramayana. Rama, for some people, is a god. Some people, he's a human being. When they talk, folk people talk about Sita being sent to the husband, so they're talking about Sita as if she's the girl next door. For Bhaktas, Rama is something else. This deification of Rama, Professor Setta was asking this question, when did it begin? It began way back in 7th century, because Kulashekara Alvar, one of the earliest Alvars, was great. He was a great Rama Bhakta. And whenever he went into, wherever he went, he carried an image of Rama with him. And he was so passionately involved in Ramayana, when his guru, every day he was reading out Ramayana, so Valmiki Ramayana to him. When he was reading out the story of Sita's abduction, he flew into a rage. How come somebody can abduct my mother? Immediately he called, raised his army. Come, let's go. Let's invade Lanka. Let's defeat Ravana. Bring Sita back. And he was so mad in his bhakti, he wouldn't listen to anybody. And he took his army. Then people, ministers didn't know what to do. Then Lord Rama took pity on him. He appeared before him. No, no, I've already defeated Ravana. You go back to your palace. Rest at peace, he said. Till then he wouldn't listen. So it was such a great Rama Bhakta. There's many compositions about Rama. And Karnataka also produced so many devotional, wonderful devotional poems about Rama. Tirumangaya Alvar also has many compositions about Rama in Tamil Nadu. Of course, you have Kamma Ramayana and so on and so forth. So Rama has long been a god. In North India, there is Saguna Rama and Nirguna Rama. And Tulsidas cult is Saguna Rama. In Kabir Pant, it is Nirguna Rama. In South India, Rama is both Saguna and Nirguna, is both form and formless. So there are innumerable stories of the Ramayana. Even Kumarvyasa, when he wrote his Mahabharata, he tells us the reason why he doesn't want to write another Mahabharata story, Ramayana story. He says, Tirukidanu Paniraya, Ramayana da Kategadali. The Paniraya, that is Adishesha, who carries the burden of the whole world, is weighed down by so many Ramayana. There are so many Ramayanas already. Kalidalu yade illa. I have no place to put my foot. Therefore, I am telling the story of Mahabharata, not Ramayana, he says. Rama's story was so popular when Kumarvyasa wrote his magnificent Mahabharata. But we had to await 20th century for there to be a great literary epic on Rama. It was our great poet Kuvempu who wrote his Ramayana Darshanam. This Rama was totally different. This Rama is not the macho Rama. He is not the militant Rama. He is Rama who is more a mother than a father. And this Rama is not for or against anybody. He is the universal principle. So in Kuvempu's Ramayana Darshanam, Sri Ramayana Darshanam, when Rama takes his avatar, all the characters, Purandara has said, so many Ramas, there's so many other Ramayana characters, so many Hanumans, so many Ravanas, so many Sitas. So all these characters came down as avatars along with Rama. Because without these avatars, Rama avatar would be incomplete, Kuvempu says. So he is everybody and he is nobody. And he starts telling the story of the human Rama, who also becomes a divinity, and the poem concludes with Nirguna Rama. The last section of the poem, which is Rama's coronation, does not happen in the human world, does not happen in the mythical world. It happens in the state of Samadhi. It takes place in Sahasradhara. So Rama becomes the ultimate principle of yoga in Kuvempu's Sri Ramayana Darshanam. There's one kind of Rama, Rama the mother. And there's another important depiction of Rama in our great modern poet Gopal Krishna Riga's poem, Ramanavamiya Divasa. And this poem is such a dense poem, within some 8 stanzas, he condenses the whole of the Ramayana story. For him, Rama is the ultimate male principle, Purushottama. He says Valmiki was able to sculpt this character because he did tapasya. Like a Purusha, he did tapasya. Hutta gatta de chitta matte ketti yeno Purushottamanayanta yanta rupa reke. Unless somebody does tapasya so much that a snake house grows on him, how can that hand depict the story of this Purushottama, the best of men, Rama? He doesn't give any credence to divine intervention. Even Rama's birth, he says, is the result of human effort, Purusha Prayatna. Kausalya Dasharatha Putra Kamishtigare Hatatta Yetagare Trikale Chakra Aspoti Sittu Srita Garishta Teja Damanir Kelapattu Vandattu Nita Gattani. When Kausalya and Dasharatha were performing the yagna of married life, that heat generated, that touched the wheel of the 3 times, and from there a spark came down into the earth and it put on the mortal earthen cloth and became Rama. So for him, Rama is Purushottama, male principle, fighting with the forces of darkness. He says, he vidrumbisthu Rama Bana Nija. When Rama shot his arrow, it penetrated darkness, yes. Kattalege hattetare nulare adosankhya. Does darkness have 1 head, 2, 10? It's innumerable. Kattarisidare badava. The more you cut it, the more it grows. Beradu kattige baruva. It not only grows up, it starts suffocating you. Beradu kattige baruva. Anadi. Kodanda danda uhiga danda. It's beginningless, therefore, even Kodanda danda, the arrow, Rama, was futile. So it's the Herculean effort of a human being and the ultimate failure of human efforts against the forces of darkness that Adiga depicts in his poetry. So one is Rama the protector. Surdas said, Nirudhana Kadana Ram, that kind of Rama. On the other hand, Rama the fighter, the combatant, who fights a crusade against the forces of darkness. So now what we have, this male Masho Rama, who has become important in our politics, in our thinking. And this is not the Rama that Surdas talked about. This is not the Rama that Gandhi talked about. This is not the Rama that Kuempu talked about. And Kuempu shows the depicts the fight between these two sides of Rama in his great play Shudra Tapasvi. In Ramayana we have the story of the Shambhuka. Shudra was doing tapasya, but then calamities begin to happen, and all these Brahmins go to Rama. Look, Shudra is doing tapasya. He has to be stopped. And according to the origin story, Rama goes and shoots this. His arrow, Shambhuka, his hedges severed, but Kuempu turns the story upside down. Rama knows, because he says, Karunalu Raghavanade Tappilla. Rama is so compassionate, he can never make any mistake. So, Rama knows that he is a great tapasvi. But he doesn't say no to the Brahmins, he knows the worth of these Brahmins. He says, okay, yes, let's go. And when he releases his arrow, that arrow goes 3 times round the Shudra Tapasvi, the Shudra ascetic, and it comes back to Brahmins. And Brahmins start running away. Oh Rama, save us from this arrow. I said, it's for him, why did it come to you? Then he said, no, please save us. He said, no, I can't save you. He's a great ascetic, he's a great rishi. Shambhuka is a great rishi. Go and touch his feet. So all the Brahmins go and touch the feet of Shambhuka, and arrow comes back to Rama. So this is how a great poet depicted the struggle between the conflict between 2 images of Rama, and he upheld Rama, not the killer, Rama, not Rama the killer, but Rama the protector. So this we have to remember in today's context. I'm very happy Honorable Guru Pamodi is here. He has been making his individual journey with the Rama story through many works for over a decade now, and I'm very happy that he's also going to talk about his experience and expression of Rama. So without any more ado, so thank you very much.